applications. Of ordinary layouts. In the experiment D1 and D2, you actually use diodes in what we call diode logic under the section which we shall cover in digital electronics called logic gates, and you actually use them to do the switching to give you the states. 00, 01, 10 ABC. So we can use them application as switches. We can apply them for rectification. For voltage regulation, and diode clipping. Or we can call it voltage limiting. In other words, if you are to have a sinusoidal wave, this being your input from the signal generator, then you can use diodes to chop off this part here. Then you have clipped. And you can use another diode on the other side of the circuit when it is reversing. Also chop off this other side. So those are the few applications we can use. Of all these, we are going to be interested in this one here and expound in order for you to understand a little bit of experiment one. Those of you are going to do it tomorrow. And nevertheless, those who did it yesterday, you'll still be able to benefit, because you'll now be able to compare what you did yesterday and what you are going to do it tomorrow, you'll be able to do it now. So we'll look at but why do we rectify anyway? So I will first take you back to high school. In high school, you were taught, especially at O level, in A level, you just referred to it. So some of you are part-time in high school, and you are part-time in, I'm sure the very few of you are given lower classes, we give you higher classes to chop backwards. Numerical. The full timers normally are given a chance to babysit the other classes. But in O level, you talked about AC and DC generators. I'm just reviewing. Before we do the rectification, why the hell we need to rectify, and what are the circumstances that or how does a generator produce DC or AC current? Alternating. AC is for alternating. And DC is for direct. All this is about the C is the current. This tube here is having the, like I said, I think from the beginning, is having current coming and going to Jinja 50 times a second. Remember me doing this. Not many of you can shake like I shake. So I can actually, you can go to Papa's. Where is Papa? He has gone to me.
No, he's sick.
He looked joyful when he came to hand me. He was energetic. At least he didn't have a pain. He went outside, picked it, came back and said, I didn't say the sickness. And they were assuming he is. I wanted to say that I could go and accept that I have been touched by the Holy Spirit. So the current goes to Jinja and back. So the turbine turns 50 times the rate, the RPM of the generator. Normally these turbines are made in such a way that you can have, or they have 50 hertz. That is 50 times a second. And that's why AC is dangerous. And that's why they tell you do not touch live wire. Otherwise you will be in trouble. But how does that happen? That happens in the sense that if we are having our concave front pieces, concave in the sense that we want to produce the same voltage, sorry, the same field across the magnets all the time. So if we put our coil, I only make one strand of the coil. In the AC generator, we have what we call slip ring. So we got slip ring at this point. And then we connect one of the sides of the coil by soldering it on this slip ring. And then we have the carbon brushes which goes to the corner. But this carbon brush is connected to a spring so that it does not scratch the slip ring. So it should be able, where it finds the bump, it should be able to maintain a corner but does not scratch the slip ring. And then the other side of the coil goes through the inside the slip ring and is put on this other, is soldered to this other slip ring. So I will draw this one around here. And this goes through and it gets to be soldered on this part here. Then you have your carbon brush, some spring, then you have your load. You can have the load being a bulb, for example. So we have carbon brush B2, carbon brush B1, slip ring S1, slip ring S2. So if we were to make the take this to be our axis of our coil, and when you pull in that string you see on the side of the generator, you are actually giving a kick, the first kick of the coil produces the initial current. That's why you have to do it so fast, or the border guy has to kick the border. So turn the generator, the generator of the motorcycle to bring the first spark, the first high current to spark the the engine of the generator or of the motorcycle, and then starts, then now starts taking the fuel. So what happens is you pull, the coil turns, those many times that you have given it. So assuming it turns in this direction, and it is X, Y, W, Z. By Fleming's right hand rule, let me see those who can immediately. I had a teacher who would do like this. A bunch of you can't no thought, and they come up with this from nowhere. Find them doing. So since we are going to generate power, we need to use the energy. So you, except some of you who use the left hand to write, but for us who use the right hand, infinity is the only way to generate. So we use Fleming's right hand rule in order to know the induced current. So I will have to use this. So I will draw my right hand. So I have this thing, I am a realist, so I draw what I can see. If I don't see it, I fail. So this thing points this side. These two fingers are right here. This one comes here, I have the thumb here. Too big. Yeah, so this is the... These are my stupid nails. So this is the thumb. This for motion, where the coil would be going. This is my second finger for current. This is my first finger. I can use either that or that for the field. So I will, I know the coil is going, this side is going upwards, this side is going downwards. So it means I have the, in order to know the XY current flowing, the field is, motion is in the thumb, the field is this side, so it means the current will be in the other direction. So the induced current, this being the force, then I will have this as the current, I follow the lead, so it comes here, connects this little ring, goes through the carbon brush, goes down here, comes through the bolt, carbon brush, slip ring two, and completes the circuit. Half a cycle later, that is when it has, this coil was here, I pulled, it turned, so half a revolution. Half a cycle, it means that I would be having the don't worry, I'm a drawer, so I'm an artist, so I will draw as many diagrams, so you shouldn't worry. But this is what I want you to see and understand how the AC comes about. So what if after I have had half a cycle, then Y would be here, W would be here, this would be Z, and this would be X. Watch, this slip ring here will go with its side. So the longest side now is this other side, and the shortest side will be the one on this other side. So I will be having my first slip ring. Let me try to draw it a bit. This side. So now the short side is soldered here. The long side goes through and is connected to the second slip ring. They haven't changed, the slip rings haven't changed. So I still have my carbon brush B2, slip ring S2, okay? And then I have the carbon brush B1, slip ring S1, a spring, and the ball. And I complete. There's nothing much that has changed in terms of the motion. The coil is still moving in the motion. Once I give it a kick and it has started moving and the engine starts, now it is the engine which starts rotating the coil that now produces the electricity. So that's why we put fuel in the generator. The first pull or the ignition, if the generator uses a battery, the ignition gives you the spark, gives the spark plug, the spark to start the pistons in the engine. And now it is the engine which starts rotating the coil, like the car. When I start my car, the battery only gives me the power to start the car. And then when the engine starts moving, it starts turning the dynamo. The dynamo will give me all the power I need in the car. So I can have a fridge in my car if I want, have a music theater if I can have space. If I had a van, I can put all those things and pimp my car and have everything. As long as I'm on the road and the engine is rolling, I'll have everything that I want. But let's see what happens to the current direction. So I still have the current. This one is still moving up. This side is still moving. The current hasn't changed the direction. It will still go in this direction. But watch how continuous it goes. So the current here is still in this direction, going in this direction, comes here, I follow it, it jumps this, because it is not connected to this slip ring. So it comes to this slip ring, to this carbon brush, goes down here, goes up here, goes into this slip ring, goes back to this side, and completes. So, if we took the side, sorry, this one I did not complete. If we look at the sides on the left here, this current is going up. Where is this current going?
Down.
This current is going down. Where is this one going? That's the concept of alternating current. So, that was, this was half a cycle, the current was going in this direction. Then on the other cycle, to complete the cycle, because now when it was here, it went here, we had this. Then it goes back. Because I can't show people who dance and then the whole internet. Not many of you can do that, so I cannot twist my hand and make it that. So I have turn it back. So this one continues to be this way. So it comes back to this side. Here. Then it goes back. And then, so it continues. Hence the idea of AC. But, so if our generator produces this sinusoidal current, we may need to change it into DC. That's why, because most of our appliances, whether it is this, the charger which enters this tablet here, it has to be DC. The charger you put in your phone is a DC. The thing you enter into your laptop is a DC. After it has been changed into DC, that adapter you put in the power constitutes the diodes that go that do the but then also have a DC generator. For it, the only thing we have to do is to split one of these and call them commutators instead of slip rings. So I'll do the same business, the same stuff of the thumb and the second finger and the first finger. So I have the, I'll not draw the magnets for purposes of swiftness. So I will draw the coil. There's a magnet here and a magnet there. Or for some of you who want to believe by seeing, let me put the magnet there. So I will have to cut the slip rings into two equal parts. But in order to make them, you know, be able to rotate around, so this side is connected here, and this side is connected here, I will take this one to be B1, then this one will be commutator 1, commutator 2, coupling brush B2, then I will have the bulb there. So, I don't know whether I should use ABCD or still use XYZ. I use ABCD. So here, nothing much happens apart from this part here for continuity is filled up with an insulator. So is here, you put an insulator so that it can turn comfortably. So it's turning through the in this part here should be going by the carbon brushes comfortably without. So at half a revolution, this one going up, this going down, you have the current here used in this direction, comes, goes down here, flows up here. So let's see, once it has gone half a revolution, what happens? So what happens is that it's only that carbon brush, sorry, commutator C2 now jumps to this side. And commutator C1 goes, but the rest remains the same. So you still have the commutators. This one solar here. And we have this is now C1, this is C2, the couple brushes are still the same, the bulb is still the same. Now this is D, C, D, A, after half a revolution. This was here, half a revolution. You lie here like this. And then the current still goes in with this going up and this going down because of the direction of motion. You still have the current going in this direction, coming down, coming, then reaches here, is connected to this commutator 1 to carbon brush 2. This is carbon brush 1, according to here. It's only the commutators which have changed, but the current will flow, come down here, go up here. Any change? This side current is up, still current is. This is down, this is. So we say that we have a DC generator. If we, instead of having this bulb here, we replace the load with the power supply, then we will be able to make the DC model. So like those days of those radio cassettes of those days, you needed the DC motor to run the compact tape, and then the only sophisticated thing in your radio cassette would be a magnetic reader sensor, but to sense the music that is on, then you start dancing. The motor would only be there to turn and run. So the batteries you whisk in those days cassette were just to turn your compact so that the magnetic tape can be able to be read by the sensor, and then you blast the music. The CD does work differently. You must be able to understand that in optics, how you are able to read the information. Things nowadays are even complicated. You insert your SD card and you start either watching movies or enjoying your music. I don't know how that works. You will tell me when you have become experts in the future. Anyone having any more confusion about, I'm sure you have forgotten, and some of you will always wonder if a generator is able to produce for us current, why do we put in fuel? We put fuel in the generator to run the engine of the generator. That running of the piston going up and down, just like that engine runs and turns the crankshaft of the car, which turns the wheels, and then you move. Every time you step on the gas pedal or the accelerator, some of you are more fast with the accelerator, you are increasing the fuel that you are putting in the engine. So the more you press, the more you put in, the more you burn, so the more the pistons move, and the more the crankshaft moves, and then you speed up. At the same time, within the engine, you have the turning also taking place, produced by the dynamo, produce the AC, which you can use in other accessories. The moment the car starts, you can plug out the battery and leave it there and drive, as long as the engine does not stall. If it stalls, then you have to look for a battery to start. But once I have started the car, you can remove the battery and dump it and drive off. It's useless. It's for just emergency, for lighting if the engine is off. Any questions? So, most generators have both plugs. Most of them have plugs for AC and even plugs for DC. And a typical generator, which is a modern generator, you can draw AC and DC. So we have produced this, now we are going to rectify it. That is the use of one of the uses of the DC, sorry, of the diodes. So at least now you know why we draw our waveform like this. You are here, you turn the coin, it gives you this, you turn it again, it gives you this, you turn it again until you turn it. So you can imagine the speed of the coin. It is moving like this and it is giving you positive minus, that's why you it hits you, you share. Because you are going up and down. You are up and down. All that time. So we shall start with the... We shall start with halfway. So if I connected my AC signal from my AC generator and I connect it to a diode, and I use a resistor. And connect the probes of the oscilloscope here to measure the V out. It means that the positive part, so I will draw these two graphs together on the same axis, on the same vertical axis. So I have the input here, and I have the output here. So I will use the so this is V in. The input, and this would be our V, V out, this one here. So here you will put in the lab, if you were to put here your sinusoidal voltage, but in experiment one we do not use a function generator, we use a handmade transformer that has transformed 220 volts to about 20 volts. So that's what you'll be using in the lab. So you'll get from the points that transformer is a setup transformer. It has an A, a CT, or senator, and has a B. Senator means that you have the primary windings, and then the secondary windings are two. One, so they are divided into two of them, whereby here you have a senator. You can tap here, for example, if you wanted 20 volts, you can get it from here, or get another 20 volts from here, or actually get a total of 40 volts. So if you get from the center here, this is point A, this is point B. If you get from the center and A, it means you're having 20. Center and B, you have 20. A and B, you have a total of 40. So if I connect my on the board for experiment one, you have a bunch of diodes, so you have one diode in there, and then another, when I put these circles, I mean where you plug the wires. Then you have another one here, and then you have where you plug the wires. And then there's space here, space there, you have another set here. Another wire, slot there. So it's up to you. If you want to use this, so you'll be getting a wire in that and wire in that, so you use this there alone. They are already set there, so you can use them as you wish. So it means a 50th of a second, this kind of flow is a 50th of a second, it will instead take this path. So it's either going this way, 50th, this way. This way, this way. That's why it will be going up like this, go down like that, go up like that, go down like that. Now when I connect the diode, when it tries to go this way, it will succeed and complete the circuit, go through the resistor and comes back. So it will complete that cycle one, I mean that half a cycle. So it will be able to go like this. Now, the other round, it tries to go this way, comes comfortably reaching here, it gets blocked. Say, please don't pass. So that cycle becomes dead. So you don't get Amen.
Then in the other round again, it gives you this. This down one, nothing. So some of you were not well. The laboratory, the lab, the transformer does not give the pure sine wave, so most likely you will see something which is almost like as if it has corners. You get a waveform in the lab which is almost like this, almost having such kind of parts, but it is actually sinusoidal. You won't get a smoothness like the one of the experiment, either 10 or these other functional generators, signal generators, which are really purely sinusoidal. But you get something because it is not well made, the transformer that we use. And then you will find that the output, the Vout, but don't grow these things and go with them in the lab. You have to grow what you see in the lab, so don't grow when you have already finished. You are supposed to grow what you see on the lab. So you are supposed to make sure that these are corresponding, especially if you want to show the phase or the electrification effect. So it means that you are only allowed, it is not allowing that part, which looks like this. This one becomes null. And then another one comes up like that. So some people were drawing something. I will do that in the next part. So this is the time. This axis is our time. So we have our, this is a half wave rectifier. Yes. This one here, this one is input. This is what the transformer means. The transformer only transforms the 220 from Ginger. The one from Ginger does not use fuel. It only uses the water. So the nylon water is the one which turns the coil. In the generator, we were using fuel to turn the coil. Ginger, the turbine will be done by the water. So it starts turning at that rate per minute to give us the 50 hertz and ends up giving us here 220 to 50 hertz signal. But that signal we can reduce it in the lab to about 220 volts to give us this input. So this input is there. It is. You are able to get it from the transformer using the oscilloscope. Now when you fit this one in here, then you chop off this negative part. Whenever you are going in this negative direction, the diode hits a stop. Or its depletion region enlarges so much and says, there's nothing that can grow in me. In reverse bias. But this is only true for when you are using an ordinary diode. If you are using a Zener diode, you reach VC and it will give you this reverse this flow current. Any other question? Yes?
Not for
you have to depend on
the output, the something in the five.
What do you get the wording in the word scales?
Scales.
not brought to scale. It's not brought to scale. And remember, you can move these waveforms either this side, or up, or down, or even make them meet each other, so you can't rely on what is on the oscilloscope, because it depends on your agility to play around with the oscilloscope. All I say in the guidelines is, as long as your graph can show me the relationship between the two, this graph of mine shows that this cycle came out as this. This one, which was supposed to come here, was cut out by the diode, so there was no signal for that time. This one came out as it is here. This one, which was about to be negative, was cut out. That's all I want.
Any other questions?
I will use 30 minutes of your dinner.
That's why I finish.
Two, can't you miss dinner for once?
No.
You will get logistics. From the cabinet, not from me. We can try to implement a full wave by actually trying to make sure there is a signal all the time, making sure that we also put a way to make sure that if this path here comes, something comes out of that one. So, A, under full wave verification, we can use the center tab, using a center tab transformer like in the experiment one that you've been doing or you can do. So implying that I got the sinusoidal input and then I have the other side of the and then turns in the primary, and then I have turns in the secondary, and then I have it as a center tap, so I have this center tap, and then I have the diode here. This goes to the output. And then I have this one going to another diode, D2, D1, now R, this is R here, this is the output, D out, and this is our VI, or V in. Can use V in here or V out. The graphs will be the same. So the other part is B. You can use a bridge. Still, you can reconstruct a bridge on your experiment one, so here these are the, this is the symbol for the IRE core one. So these are primary windings, IRE core one, secondary windings. This is the center tap. Here for the experiment, this would be CT, center tap. This would be your A, and this would be your lab. Your manual. And this means that this will be your negative here, and this will always be your positive. I'll explain how that happens in a few minutes. Or you can use a bridge, using a bridge that's fire, after putting, you know, putting, you know, use all the diodes on that experiment. So you have the, this one there, and then you have your diamond here, or your bridge, so you'll have the diodes, these ones going up. And this one's going this side. This one going this side. And then we have the this connector there. This coming this side. This bearing here. Finally, having our output here. This will always be positive. This will be minus. So. I need to add on a little bit of more cycles. I've got the two more. I have this. So this, how can I push this down? Draw this a bit shorter, but when you are drawing, don't make it short, make it nice. I'm avoiding the rough. So I will first add this. Now, in this full wave one, where we shall have the D2, D1, D4, D3, D8, and D8. So this is what happens. For this case, implementing the full wave with a center tap transformer is that this is primary, second, then you have induced the current, the alternating current here. So at a 50th of a second, it goes like this, completes the circuit along here, and gives you a positive at this part. A 50th of a second comes down here, goes up here, can't come here, and completes the circuit. So all the time you'll be having a value here, a positive value voltage here, whether it is when it goes through the positive or goes through the negative side. And if it goes here, you don't expect anything to come here because there is a direct block in it. So you'll be having always another signal instead of when you are supposed to go to negative, it will still dump for you a positive value here. And that continues and continues and continues. Those who have already done the plan before, you had this, as I've said, you have a very effective looking graph, and then you end up having these ones for half wave, and then for full wave, some of you were drawing as if you are drawing flowers like this. Don't draw that. It's the same thing here. So this one
becomes positive, positive, everything becomes positive. Same thing with here. You have the current at the first round going in this direction, can't come here, goes here, can't come here, goes here, and completes the circuit. Okay? Then the second round, it tries to go through here, can't come here, goes here, can't go there, still comes out. So it has been made direct. You can only get a plus here and a minus here. There's nothing like alternate. So every time, every round, this cycle here comes here, goes through here. This half a cycle in the negative, which should have gone through this side, can't go there, still comes out from. And then you would have made it a direct. That's how we, why we call it a rectifier or rectification process. So this is what happens in your radios. You transform your voltage from that high to 20 to 12. After making it 12, you come here, have a bunch of diodes, and rectify it and make it DC. After making DC, you enjoy your music. So allow me to write something small. So, those who have done it, you were told do not ground at CT. As you can see, this part here is your grounding for the output. Okay? So if you were connecting your, at these two points, you are connecting at these two points here to make sure that you get the input. You remember? And after you are, when you connect and you are getting your input, and then you want to get the output, and then you ground, when you ground this part here, if you try to put your oscilloscope and ground it here, it means that you have, it's like you have made your output, I don't know how to call it. Some of you, you will find that you got the graphs looking similar in both input and output. Because you have given them a common ground. This is the ground or common for your output. If you ground here using an oscilloscope, again you make this worse. Meaning that you are going to look to have the same thing. It's like you are measuring the same thing. If you put here your red probe, here you put your blood probe, and you want to say this is my input, and then you get the other probe of the oscilloscope, you put it here, and also put it here. What is the difference between these two points? It's the same. Because the current is, whatever is flowing here is coming up here. This is the forward direction. So you'll be having the same graphs looking alike. So you are like, why am I getting funny things? So you are not supposed to do that. You are supposed to instead get your input around here, and then ground this. You say that this CT is this point here where you're in. And similarly here, if you ground this point, your CT is around this one here. So if you ground this point, it means that you are making it look like this. So this, if you make this point and this one the same, then you won't get this value here. You want to get the one which goes through here, but the one which goes down won't go through. So you will again get half wave. And both of the graphs give you half wave. So you won't be able to get input and output at the same time on the same screen. You get the sense? So I'm going to remove this and we write some two pages.
Yes.
I apologize. I spent a lot of time reminding you your high school things.
whereas the electrification board is both half wave and full wave, rectified voltages. Above means what we have already drawn. Have each a single polarity. Meaning you have plus on the other side here, the minus on this side. They are not very useful. Because of this reasoning here, because of this way it looks. They are not very useful because they fluctuate. Because they fluctuate too much between peak and zero. Remember, those who have done this experiment, you will see your graphs are too shaky. You have to change it into digital mode, and then still you see it shaking around. We need a more steadier, rectified voltage. And we can afford this by having or using the services of the filter. So a filter is required to achieve this. The simplest filter, is the RC, is the resistor capacitor filter, RC filter, obtained by connecting the capacitor across the output load. Resistor R. So the rectifying voltage, will be of the form below. DC, when you're using an oscilloscope for DC, if the previous it was here and you connect the like a dry cell, it will jump that voltage upwards. So you will have your graphs getting a ripple, and those of you who did this experiment you got this before after connecting the resistor, or how you are getting a resistor, the V out along the resistor, and then they tell you to put the capacitor, which is also embedded within that experience. So that you make an RC, but they have to be in parallel. So you have a C and your R here. This one gives you the RC theta. So this would be your VPP. This one here is your VPP, peak to peak. From this horizontal, you get your VDC, and then this is your VF. Once you put field, so the field and voltage consists of a DC voltage, VDC, and a small AC voltage, and a small AC voltage, which is a ripple voltage, this one here, on top of the DC. So the small ripple, the smaller the ripple, the better the rectifier. So the ripple factor small r is equal to the V root mean square value over the VDC, and the V root mean square value is the root mean square value, root mean square value of the rift. Root mean square value means that equivalent AC that causes the same effect as that of the DC. Exercise, we crack in the new manual 9.1. In other words, this ripple here you are seeing is this. Once you have gotten the full wave rectification, the ripple is this value here, which you get this one here. So this ripple here, the smaller the ripple, you can see this is a small ripple. Compared to if you were looking at such a ripple here, sharp, then you have this, then you have sharp, sharp one here. So along this part here, this one here, you are actually having the charging of the capacitor, and here you are having the discharging of the capacitor. See you tomorrow in the lab.